All right, Peace Fam, yo, make sure you check out this episode. I'm on Imani, and I'm traveling right now. I'll give y'all some footage of that. But, hey, I'm sitting here, two of my brothers in arms, and, of course, the barber. So while I'm sitting here, I'm going to have a conversation with the barber real quick. We focus it on Imani, even though it's not Imani yet. Get into that quick discussion, as well as just find out some stuff about the Baba. Alright? Make sure you tune in. External, and we got this healthy drink. We got that Ambrosia. That's my new label. Make sure y'all check that out. But here we go. This came from Chicago, celebrating one of our elders. Got an interview with another one of my elders. We about to kick it now. We about to salute those ancestors. All right. So first, shouts out to our creator. Want to make sure that we shout out our creator by whatever name you choose to call it, creator. We want that energy around us. We know it's all around us. But we want to remind ourselves. So we toast to creator. We toast our personal ancestors at this time. As I told you this morning, time is about our personal ancestors. We remember those ancestors. Yesterday I remember no more angst. You got any personal ancestors you want to recognize, toast. Know your family line. It's important that we remember those that connect us to things that's bigger than ourselves. So we toast them. We toast this present moment right now as Imani, faith. We heard the Bible talk about faith. We seen some of the party. We had a good time. Faith, you know what I'm saying? Conscious faith. Consciousness means nothing but being awake and being aware. Be aware of where you are and when you are. We toast that. Remember the story of the week. We're going to toast this present moment. Imani. We are Imani right now. Toast. And Imani. And last but not least, we toast our children. Our children just look important. And we remember them so that one day they can remember us. Toast and we say Ashe. 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 As we say in Giami. 100 years. Now, make sure y'all know, those family members that support me, I told you we only had, I'm only doing that original, and Ginseng will be available, Ginseng and original, and I'm letting y'all know, half of what I got is already gone. I ain't been back in town, they done called me already, this is gone, so... Peace. Y'all have to wait. Some of y'all have to wait till the next production. I'm still working on the lemon line because I want to make sure it's good. I want to make sure that the mix comes out right. Because I had a complaint about the mix. Y'all seen me sample that. So with that, I'm saying peace. Bob on the back sleep. Brother Devin driving. Brother Sean film. So, hey, that. I say I love y'all. Thank y'all for tuning in. You know what I'm saying? And great Imani family, this is going to be a long time, so I'm trying to do several things at once, but I'm sitting here with the Baba, as y'all can see, me and the Baba is going to have a conversation, so we're going to put that right there.
All right.
You can hear the music in the background. Let me fix the angle first. All right, peace. Like I said, here with the Baba. Y'all see me on our way somewhere. Actually, it's a surprise birthday party, so this won't post to after the party.
Right.
So, you know, we want to celebrate Elder Gaylord Thomas. And we on the road. We'll give y'all some footage. But I'm sitting with the Baba, as you can see, looking all smooth and debonair. And first off, Baba, tell us about... why they call you Baba?
Well, first of all, I'm glad to be here. I feel like I'm going to be on Late Show, TV show somewhere. But Baba, that's why he healed me, Father of the Village. And that's an honor to be called that. I'd rather be called Baba than Doctor any day. But and plus, for me, it's real significant to be here with three sons. I've been knowing these young men in this car now since they were about 14 years old. And now, in fact, to be able to go to sleep while y'all driving, that's an accomplishment for me.
Well, those that know me, I go to sleep anyway.
Right. Yeah, well, you sleep anyway. You're right about that. But so, okay. Like we said before, we're going to a birthday party for an elder. I'm emphasizing elder because I don't go to olders. Birthday parties. This guy here is an elder who's been for years been giving out good messages about life, and actually one of the founders of Simba, and he has so many stories and memories and victories that he's accumulated and he shared with everybody. And it just feels good to be on the road to go and celebrate his birthday without him knowing it. I just feel good to me.
Well, knowing Gaylord, I know for a fact Gaylord probably already know that something is going down.
Something's going down. You don't know what.
You don't know what. But you know something is going down. Somebody done gave away something.
Something.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Because you don't get to eldership. Now let's talk about that. Because you said an important term. You said you don't go to older's birthday party. So can you define for the people that, you know, that tune into Jami Johnny, what is the difference between an elder and an older?
Well, in my estimation, you know, when you talk about rites of passage, look down to make sure everybody knows rites of passage is, first of all. I mean, you got to be a certain chronological age to be an elder. But you also got to be a certain mental age to be an elder. Mm-hmm. There are a lot of men who might be 50 years old, and that's chronological. But then they could have a mental age of 18, sagging and acting a fool. And our kids don't need to see that and think that's an elder. Because you're old, that don't make you an elder. And I think that an elder is the one always dispersing information to somebody, somewhere, sometime. You know, you can't help it. It just happens that way. And so I try to promote as much as I can a real elder, because we're lacking that. You got too many people impersonating being an elder. You know, even in Columbus, a lot of time I go someplace, somebody said, "Man, when you gonna stop working?" I said, "Who said I was working?" First of all, you have to have a passion. And I know I always had a passion for talking when I was a kid. It got me in trouble. But now it's working for me. And I love it. So I just don't have time for that.
All right. So, hey, now, if there was one thing that you wanted to leave with people that's watching with us in this car, because we got two other brothers listening in. Oops, falling and he can't get up. Hold on. I'm just trying to put the charge cord in. Y'all excuse us. Y'all know how we do it on Geometry Journey. We keep it real. I want y'all to understand this is happening in real time. This is real life, right? So if there's one thing that you would want young men, I ain't that young anymore, but if you want that, you want to pass on to it, what would it be? What would be the information that you would want us to get?
Well, first of all, Javier Sanchez, a young man I've been knowing for a long time as well, has an important way he delivers messages. I would say that I think that I would like for young people to listen to him, because he talks about not raising a kid for a job, but for a life experience, something you're going to be happy with. And happiness comes from the inside out. No matter what somebody tells you, the bling and the outside stuff is just temporary. So if you find something that you really, really like to do that makes you happy, then I would say pursue it. Because if you don't, the other stuff will wear off. You know, all of us have been through a lot of traumatic experiences in the past. And sometimes we need positive experience to remember. So that'll offset the negative things, because we all are born with a purpose. But unfortunately, a lot of times, somebody might laugh at your purpose. And when they do, that will discourage you from pursuing it. So some kind of way, I would say as elders, we have to be patient with our young people and teach them the seven principles of Kwanzaa. I know that sounds commercial, but if you internalize those principles, there's nothing there that you can accomplish if you really internalize it. Now, if you do what we call a passive-aggressive approach, just talk it and don't walk it. And I don't mean just on Kwanzaa time. I don't mean in church. I mean every day. I mean, when I come out of Turkey Hill, if I feel like I'm coming out of church every day, because I see somebody I know that remembers something that I left them, and that makes me feel extremely good. I don't want to ramble, but this topic for me is I'm so passionate about it, because I really believe that if we could alleviate and help kids channel that anger to energy, we'd be all right. I mean, there's an expression I use sometimes. If you keep your intellect over your emotions, you could do a lot more things than when you put your emotions over your intellect.
Okay.
And your emotions sometimes are tied in with anger and a lot of other stuff too. And passion. You know, think about basketball. For a long period of time, who would think somebody could jump from the foul line and dunk a basketball without traveling? So we had to innovate and make things better for us. I know it sounds crazy, but we're the most creative people on the world to adapt, to change. And even if you go back far as eating chitlins, why do we eat chitlins? But look at us today. We don't have to eat them now. But that's all I was left. But man, them mama sure made it taste good. Mm. And you have to admit it, some of you still like it. Now, it's not good for you.
I miss it.
Yeah, but don't mean you have to have it, but at least we know we had to something to survive that didn't kill us. Mm. Eat each other. So that's what we got to get back to. We got to get back to more self-love. For yourself first, because it's not nobody's job to love you. You got to love yourself first. That's the way I believe.
For us in Giami, today is Kaumba. Now, let me bring this up to y'all. The Bible don't know about the Nguza Saba challenge, but you see, it went into the Nguza Saba. Now, for those that may be new to this, the Nguza Saba challenge, Baba, is where we have colonized the week. We discovered the week. Mm-hmm. And we have defined each day of the week with a Nguza Saba principle. As a matter of fact, Deshaun is up there working on a calendar right now just for this purpose. And today is Kaumba. And I want to discuss a little bit about Kaumba with you and then get into Imani. So you said that it's important for somebody to find a purpose and to follow their passion. Now, before we can get to that, give us some clues on how a person like myself, who may be out here, how do I find that passion? How do I fly and plug into it?
Well, first of all, I think you have to, since I kind of know you anyway, unfortunately, there's a DSM-5 psychological disorder called oppositional disorder. Mm-hmm. Well, hell, all I could be oppositional. Mm. And if you're not oppositional, you're going to be the same way all the time, and no new idea is going to happen. Mm. We need challenges. You know, even as parents, we need a challenge. So when you get that challenge from that person, don't take it as them being obstinate. Take it as them, they really trying to find out in their way of who they want to be and help perpetuate it. For example, in one of Javier's talks, I heard him say something like, it was really interesting, how if a kid like to make noise or do some stuff, give him a djembe, something like this. There are games and activities that you can do with your kid to pour out the activity. Look at it in a positive way versus the negative way. If we took an attitude of being half full versus half empty a lot of times, I think we'd be a lot better off. Oprah Winfrey talked about when she was a kid, she got in trouble all the time for talking. So what did they do? They made her class president. Mm. You know, and then look, and I have to tell you Oprah's story. I'm just saying that when you help develop a passion in a kid, you'd be surprised. The creator will take care of the rest of it, but we got to cultivate it. That plant needs something to grow in. And I just believe that we got to stop opposing our kids, but really listen to them a lot more to pull things out of them. There's, I know for myself, I've always got accused of talking too much, but it made me be a doctor too. Now, I always wanted to be a doctor, but I thought I wanted to be a physical doctor to take care of the body. But that's not my challenge. My challenge is to take care of the mind. Mm. And I appreciate that. My kids used to say, when they grew up, we didn't get no spankings. They said, but we always had to talk. I said, well, that's all right. Now they understand why. So I do think that there's just, it's hard to give a definite blueprint on exactly how to pull out that passion. But it's already there. And you can hear it. And you can see it. But it's up to our job to cultivate it. And, you know, but it's already there.
Provide those spaces where
that's right.
You can feel safe enough. Because you often talk about sanctuary.
Oh,
like
yeah.
When we're doing our exercises, he will set up a sanctuary, let everybody know what sanctuary means. And then the stuff that we brought out in that session will stay in that session. So we need to be able to develop places of sanctuary.
Absolutely. In fact, that's what Simba represents. Safe in my brother's arms, or safe in my sister's arms. Safe to talk about those things that you think people are going to laugh at you about. Things that you think you've forgotten. The pain that you've been through. People say, well, y'all get over that. But we all have emotional clocks. And my clock might be different from yours. So, but to have a place where you can sit and talk to someone and they don't judge you, it's a very important space to have. I think it's Alicia Keys that talked about being the space, being the place in somebody's diary. Think what your diary is all about. A place where you can put some stuff down and it's safe. I think that's what we need to be able to do, that get rid of this stuff, but it just don't go away. Because there are a lot of things that happen to us that we haven't forgotten. And everybody been on me, but next year this time, I will have my book out, and it's called Emotional Pillows. And the reason why I'm having such a hard time, because I'm getting new information all the time about what I can put in it.
Right.
But someone told me the other day, said, listen, just stop. Whatever you got so far now, put this in the book. And I think that would help with this whole psychological disease, PTSD, post-traumatic stress syndrome. And that particular stress syndrome wasn't discovered not just in 1980 with the Vietnam War. It's been going on for a long, long time for all of our kids, black kids, white kids, you name it. But unfortunately, because of the way the system is so systemic with the racism, the people of color have been suffering more so that way in this country than others. But we have to do something to combat it. But first, you don't know what it is. This whole thing is real. The attitudes and I think that the feelings that we have is like alcoholism. And alcoholism has been coined as cunning, baffling, and powerful. And when you do that, when you can assimilate and understand that process, it's the same way it happened with our kids to make them think that they know good or that they don't know who they are. So I think with rites of passage and having a safe place to talk where nobody can come back and get you, is what we need to do, have more of. I remember Bobby Kelsey said that he wished you could have a rites of passage or a safe place for kids to talk, adults too, every so many miles within Columbus. And we need that more. It's just like even when we do sweat lodges. You just can't go any place to do a sweat lodge. Maybe that'd be another sacred place that we can talk about sometime in the future. But a sweat lodge is a nice place to have, to go and vent, and that'll help keep you balanced. That's one reason why they took it out of prison for a while, but then now they had to put them back. Because the prisoners who were practicing that ritual wasn't going in the hole. The guards had nothing to do. Because they were in a space where they felt like they'd been reborn, get in touch with their ancestors and so forth, and that was their ritual. So I really believe that providing sacred places is so important. Or I like to call them safety circles. A safety circle is when you're in there and you're talking and you're doing things, and remember that what goes around comes around. All this stuff is connected. And I'm proud to say this too. Now, I'm in the car, like I said before, with three young men that have really helped me and is still helping me. And 2 weeks ago, I couldn't eat anything because I had a dental problem. But guess what? One of my sons last night said, 2 days ago, take some coconut oil and put it in your mouth.
That oil letting, y'all see me do it, I'm playing.
And I tell you right now, I'm going to tell my dentist, you better call Hot Tim and quit writing these prescriptions. And they go back to basic nature. I said, because I feel good. It's the first day I can eat something solid in a while. Now, I know it's a lot to share, but I can't help it. That's just the way I feel right now. I feel real good. I feel like I'm one of the most important men on earth right now. I feel safe. I feel like the legacies I'm leaving could be passed down to somebody else. Tawan Russell told me the other day, he said one thing he remembered about me, and I haven't gotten all about it, I did it. If you take Roman numeral 9, that's a 1 and then an X, take one line and make that a 6. Now, maybe sometime during the process, you can call in and tell Hatem how you can do it. Now, how many of you think you know how to do it now? Think about it. But when Tawan brought it up, he said, you know what? And I haven't forgotten about it. He said, figuring that out helped him to stay out the box or to get outside the box. And those of you who don't know how to do that, I don't know if I should tell you or not. But again, Roman numeral number 9 is made with a 1 and an X. How do you make it out of a 6? By using one line.
Alright, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to put that on the screen for y'all after I get done, show Doc some of this camera magic. And then so that it'll be sitting right here so that you can look at it and figure out how to make that a 6.
Right. Now, Tessa, I'm wearing an eagle that was given to me by Albino. He was one of the Native American brothers I've been on for a long time. Didn't know I knew him like I do.
You heard me quote him on the show, but go ahead.
Yeah, and he came to Columbus and we hosted him and couldn't find out we knew some same people that he knew and so forth. And he took his eagle off his chest and gave it to me. Boy, oh boy, you talk about an honor. Because if you don't know, that eagle is so, so sacred. You know, if you ever see a live one together, that wingspan's got to be at least 7 feet. But in the air, don't look that big. But those are big birds. And it's a sacred thing. And he gives it to me. And so I have it underneath my jammy. But I'm just saying that I didn't feel so good to have brothers and sisters. Oh, here's my jammy. See, y'all can see that. So y'all think I'm not lying. There it is.
Yeah, it is. That's mine.
There it is. He got here too. See? Is that weird? Right, right. I'm just saying, we ain't jiving.
It's fine. It's fine. So now, today is Kaumba. Now, I told y'all earlier, before they picked me up, because it's crazy you went to that. He didn't see the video, y'all. He ain't read the blog.
No.
In there, I said, creating, since there's Kaumba, creating sacred spaces. It's important as nation builders and tribe builders and families that we create sacred spaces so that we can celebrate our ancestors, so that we can celebrate who we are, so that we can be who we are, because in this world, it's almost illegal for us to be who we are. We're the only group of people that people say, you're being too much like yourself. When people look at you and be like, you're being too black.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? I told y'all.
That's when you gotta be too strong.
Right. No other people is told that they're too much like themselves.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? And we live in a country on a continent named after a white dude, with a capital named after a white dude.
Yeah.
We live in a city that's the capital of a state that's named after a white dude. We go to grocery stores with white dudes' names on it. We pull the dollars out of our pocket, and they got white people's faces on them, right? The clothes that we got on, you look at the labels, they're named after white people, and nobody ever says, that's too white.
Too white, right.
I never heard that shit.
Nah.
You know what I'm saying? So excuse me, but you know,
I get out.
But the point that I'm trying to make is we need to have a sacred space where not only our young people, but ourselves and our elders, we could come together and build. That's all about that Kaumba. Now, let's move it to the Imani, because this one is going to be premiered on Imani. Tomorrow is Imani. Imani is the day of faith. And I'm trying to focus everything through the folktale of the week. The folktale of the week is, for those that don't know, the lion and the bull. All right, so now, Barbara didn't hear the story, so I'll tell y'all real quick. The lion and the bull. The lion wanted to kill the bull. The bull was too big for the lion. So the lion had to come up with a plan to outsmart the bull. So he invited the bull to go and eat a lamb that he had slaughtered. The bull accepted his invitation and walked away with the lion. They walked towards the cave, and the bull looked into the cave of the lion, and he didn't see a slaughtered lamb. But what he did saw, he saw a spit that was big enough for him, and he saw a pot that was big enough for him. And he stopped, and the lion looked at him and asked and said, my friend, why are you going away from me? Why are you leaving? I haven't done anything to offend you. He said, I don't see any sign of a slaughtered lamb, but what I do see is that you have a pot and a spit big enough for a bull. So this whole week I'm focusing. So with Imani, what I'm talking about is a lot of us move towards the cave of our enemies in faith. You know what I'm saying? We're not looking at the physical evidence of what's going on, their intentions. And what is the lesson that, as an elder, that you would give about Imani, about faith?
Well, with that story, but with faith, I'm not sure, but wait a minute now, the lion was going to eat the bull.
The lion wanted to eat the bull. He couldn't. The bull was too big.
Too big.
To kill him. So he had to come up with another way to get him. So he figured that if he get him to his cave, he would be able to eat with him. And when the bull went down to eat the lamb, by the way, the lion would be able to attack him.
Well, just off the top of my head, I think that that happens in life in relationship to maybe even somebody who all of a sudden not want to be your friend is not your friend anymore. I mean, well, would pretend to be your friend and really isn't. Or they may want something from you that they couldn't get before. Now they're going to trick you. Sometimes, well, of course, you know about drugs and alcohol, that'll do it as well. But somebody else is abusing it, and they want company. Mid-year life company. And this whole thing about a sheep and wolf clothing is the same way. Your basic instinct should tell you. I think that sometimes we don't go with our basic instinct. How many times have you said, "Now I know this is wrong, but you do it anyway"?
Right, right, right.
You know, so I think we got to be careful of that and be leery of that. And I've done it even with sometimes people call me an old man like that. I said, well, I said, that's good because I'm old. Because sometimes you don't dare to get old. And so I think that lion tried to pull that bull. I got to think a little bit more about that too, with that analogy.
Now, but check this out. Those out there that's not, hopefully you're listening. What's wrong with a bull going to eat a sheep?
For one thing, a bull don't eat meat. I mean, but I know it's a parable.
Right,
but even the parable, that's ridiculous. I said someone like, you don't get something for nothing. Mm-hmm. You know, it's just like, but man, come on, dude, this is free. No, it's not.
It's not free.
And it may look like it, but it's not. I don't even think a bull has the right kind of teeth.
Don't even have the right type of teeth to eat meat.
And he couldn't even digest it.
Couldn't even digest the meat.
So
he operating outside of himself.
Right.
To impress something that.
Right. And when you were telling me that, I had to start thinking. I'm looking and absorbing all this. But if you really think about it, I mean, a bull eating a sheep, but yet it still look good. I'm going to get you. Something. You gotta know that's something wrong. And that happened to us a lot of times. Think about yourself personally. Even after this broadcast, how many times have you been fooled? And if you don't know, ask somebody. You know, because you gotta take an inventory of some things about our lives. And that bull eating a sheep, think about it. I only got bowlers, to tell you the truth. That's a very good example of it. I'm trying to think mine personally. Something happened to me. I think boldness not to overcome a lot of it. I have to think about that from them. But I know that I've been a victim of that myself.
So we should. Now, one of the things I want to bring up about faith is, even in our faith, Imani, I think we got to ask questions. Is that bull, the bull obviously is not asking questions. What the fuck I'm gonna, excuse me, what I'm gonna do with sheep meat? You know what I'm saying? I don't, like you said, I don't even have the proper teeth to even consume something like that. You know what I'm saying? And I'm,
because he can, you think you can.
Right.
That don't make sense. No. I mean, and you know, there are a lot of us look at someone else doing something. Well, how come I can't do it too? Mm. Because that's not you. Mm. For one thing, and when you try to make yourself somebody else, then you could be doing it for somebody else, and you wonder who the hell you are after a while.
Right.
For real, because the real you is not there. The essence of you had to be used all the time, especially in crisis situation. And when you, and like he said before, having faith is knowing that if you do what you're supposed to do, have faith, it's gonna work for you. You know, you gotta have faith that when you take a step, you're gonna be able to take another. When you're walking, even. You can't assume, because some people fall down. Mm. But even a little baby. You ever see a little baby taking steps and so forth? And say, oh, I got faith now. After a while, they build up to it. They bought it, but then they build up to it. But it's, in your mind, you got to know that it's going to happen, and it does happen. But you got to have faith, and not just saying the words. You got to really believe it. Imani.
Imani. Imani is a powerful principle. The Maitic principle that go along with that day is harmony. The Hermetic law that go along for tomorrow is a gender, the law of gender. For the M7, which is the Millennium 7, which we use for the school, the word is trust. So all those line up on that day, because as I keep telling y'all, I colonized the day. They didn't mind coming over to America claiming it was theirs, so I don't mind taking a week and claiming that it's ours.
In my mind, it's mine all the time, not just a week. If they're like Black History Month, I don't particularly care for that term. God thinks you have Black History Moments, period. Mm-hmm. And when they say things like they're taking out teachable moments in public schools, that's crazy. That's almost saying, I got an agenda, I'm gonna push my agenda, I don't care about yours. Because something may come up that you have to attend to right then, but my curriculum says I can't do it.
Right.
Oh no, you gotta have your own personal curriculum within your mind of how you wanna handle things. Because now, if not, these principles are so intertwined with each other. You're not practicing your cookie chocolate lid, you're not defining yourself. So we really have to rely on the principle and internalize them. When you internalize, then there's change. First of all, there's a whole model for change. If you want to change something, you have to first be aware of what it is you want to change. Sometimes it's not easy.
That's that consciousness I'm
telling
you about.
You've got to be aware of it. Then after you make aware, then you make a commitment. I'm going to do this. You develop that skill, just keep on developing. You might fall down now and then, but then when you accept it, you internalize it, then there's change. You know, if somebody would ask you how to ride a bicycle, you couldn't even tell them. Because you've been doing it so long. But you really broke it down, you got to get a balance, first of all. But a lot of things we've forgotten on how to get there. And I really believe those principles are little stepping stones and footnotes on how to live your life every day. And I always believe in taking a fearless and moral inventory of what you're doing every day. When I worked at TECO, Training Institute of Central Ohio, when I was a young man, about 19 years old, I had boys in a cottage. Best time for me to talk to them was at night, before they went to bed. And I would always ask them things like, okay guys, we all better go to bed now, but tell me something today that you did that made you angry. And we talked about that. Then for them to go to sleep, I said, now tell me something to make you feel good. Oh, we had a nice conversation like this. Then they go to bed. I'd even set up an example. I asked one time, I said, suppose you were on a date with a girl, and you wanted to really impress her, and you got to this restaurant, and she ordered all this stuff, and you couldn't find out you had no money. What would you do? And there was comments come up like, well, I would tell her to meet me at the back door. I'm going to use the restroom, and we sneak out. And then every now and then, so one boy said, no, I would call my uncle and say, can you come and get me an uncle? But meanwhile, I would tell the restaurant manager, sir, I'm sorry, I'm embarrassed, I didn't have any money, like that. The next scenario, the young man said, well, I would ask the girl I'm with. To tell you the truth. I mean, and be honest with him, like this, to go to show that we need to be together as a balance, like this. And that type of conversation on their level really helped them to process a lot of things about the good side of principle, having faith all the time. And obviously, it comes to kids on their level, first of all, not yours. In fact, that's why I got a statue now of an old man with a little chair he carries with him. He carries that chair so that he could sit down on it and be at the level of these young people that he works with every day. And I try to do that with my mind. Even though I always get down on my knees, I try to get down to their level, where they are. Because when I get down to their level, that brings me up along with them. There's just so many different concepts. But you have to internalize this stuff. You just can't just read a book and do it. it's got to be something that you've already been doing.
So action is a major.
Stipulate. Major. And it's not just temporary. You got to have faith. I mean, you got to have action all the time in anything that you're doing. I don't care what you say.
So all the principles that you heard it from now, all the principles are energized by action.
And take your own inventory. Find out which one have you utilized today.
All right. So when you say inventory, can you kind of, what do you mean?
Emotional inventory. For example, think about today. Who defined you today? What did you do today that somebody tried to get you out of your comfort zone? What did you do to combat that? When were you challenged today? Today, did you take your intellect over your emotions? Because no one, it's crazy not to get mad. You're going to get mad. I can't just shut that off. But did you flip it and make it positive versus negative? To me, every day we should take, sit down for yourself, either write it down or think about, what did I do today that helped me out emotionally and physically? Also, I think you ought to find out what you ate today.
Mm.
You know, because I tell you, food has a way of turning this energy that you have into something negative or positive. You know, I feel a certain kind of way when I eat a certain kind of food, to tell you the truth. So, eat some things that I drink or don't drink. You know, of course, you know, unfortunately, people think alcohol make you feel good too. Yeah, right, temporarily. But, it's, you know, that's a depressant. People don't think it is. People think it's a stimulant because it makes you act crazy. But it's really a depressing drug.
Mm.
And I tell you something else to a drug we don't use too much. It's dopamine. And we can create that by the good feelings that we have. That's what dopamine does. But also, believe it or not, gentlemen, we've been told that a man is not supposed to cry. Well, I wonder why the Creator gave us tear ducts. Because there's some ingredients in tears that actually smooth out depression. And we didn't know that for a long time. But there's some chemical properties in tears that really make you feel good after you get through going. Why do you think you go to sleep after something? Why do you think that when you cry, you take a sigh of relief? You know, now if nobody's laughing at you, then you let it out. But if they start laughing, then you hold in, and you can't hold that stuff in. Suppose you didn't use the bathroom for 5 days. Mm. What would happen? Huh. So psychosomatic illness is just the same as physical illness. So we just got to remember that the mind, what they say, is a terrible thing to waste. So I'm just saying that we didn't need to be able to express and get some of this stuff out versus yielding to that negativity or that... we have naturalized things that's not natural.
Mm.
And we got to be real careful with that.
Hey, you know? we doing like the bull.
Like, there we go. There we go. He bringing it back that way.
We doing like the bull. We acting outside of our nature.
That's right.
We have been taught that it's okay to act outside of our nature. Wow.
We've been taught to act outside of our nature in our relationships with ourselves. We've been taught to do something unnatural in relationship with our women.
Mm.
Now that's the one that really, 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 I think that we need to get back together again a lot more. I saw somebody on Facebook, some boy beating a girl.
Mm.
That didn't make any sense to me, you know. And then on social media reinforced that kind of stuff. And I don't understand, that's not us beating our women like that. And then they kicked the girl. I mean, what kind of mentality allows you to kick a female on the ground, especially your sister?
Mm.
I know of a young man one time. The mother came to me crying. She said, guess what? My son kicked me. My own son. I said, was he on drugs? She said, yeah. I said, well, see, there we go. It's not him. That was not your son. That was something inside of him that made him act that way. This sort of thing. But I really do believe that we got to retrieve what's normal for us. Because that part is definitely not normal. Not when our mothers have sacrificed their lives, threw them off. Rather than having their kids enslaved, they'd rather jump in the Atlantic Ocean. But I'm just saying that we have to get back too. Well, I'm like, that song with Tupac, Robert Vine. Like, Mama, I love that song. And I think there's so many lyrics, so many things in that song that bring back memories of a good mother. I like Sadie, myself, by the Spinners. You know, that song always brings tears to my eyes. So I'm just saying that we need to slow down the process and normalize what really is normal, not what the abnormal.
So, just because I know we almost where we need to be, but give us a picture of a normal, if what type of behaviors should we kind of focus on in normalizing and making, helping us become normal? Because a lot of us never had these images. You know what I'm saying? Because we say, like, for example, we tell a kid to behave, but it's hard for them to behave if they have never seen it. What it is.
That's right.
So when we tell people, you know, we are acting outside of ourselves, they can see plenty of that. But what would a healthy black man in the positions that we're in, what would they be acting like? What are some of the things, some of the traits that we need to be looking for?
Well, For me, I've been noticed here lately, for example, if I'm in public, I speak, first of all. And I think that's where we got to start, at least just speaking to people. And when you do it, say, oh, hi. You'd be surprised how many people will speak back at you. And I know a lot of older men don't want to do that because they're afraid of our younger boys. And that, to me, is ludicrous, to be afraid of our own kind. So I think speaking is one thing. Hold the door for another brother when he comes to the store. I think that if you see somebody fighting, at least approach them some kind of way. I understand that there's some things that are going on with weapons, and you know, you don't want to be involved with it, but we got to take the chance on helping to resolve some of this conflict. We also got to give examples of how we do it. Now, I think we all have to, for example, watch what we say about women. In other words, as an elder, I got to show an example of what a real man's all about, like working every day. I'm not saying I don't cuss every now and then, but I think it's important to be consistent. If you say you're going to do something, you do it. I think that it's just important that we, any moment, be able to correct any behavior we see in a child, or be able to disperse information all the time. I had to go back to Turkey Hill for a minute. The reason why, Turkey Hill, this particular one.
For those that don't know, Turkey Hill is a gas station
in
Columbus. It might be nationwide, but just so that y'all know.
And it's kind of a meeting place for, you know, get a cup of coffee, but everybody stops in there, especially from the east side. And because of the constituents that I work with, a lot of guys work in there. And it feels so good when I go in there. It's hard for me to get out because they always got something to ask me or say something to me. It's like they'll say, how you doing? I said, BB. They say, what's that mean? Black and busy. They said, ooh, I like that. I said, no. I said, I forgot one. I'm black. No, I'm blessed first, black second, and busy. They said, and it has to be in that order. Like that. And so they said, well, you know, I never thought about it that way. I said, I'm blessed to even be up here smiling and caring and be able to get the message out. So a lot of people are writing it down, say, oh, I like that. I'm going to tell y'all myself. I'm BBB. And they'll say, thanks, Elder, for the message. Or some young man said, hey, OG, like that. I said, what does OG mean? Like that. He said, they'll say, like, not an old gangster, just an old guy, but you're more than an old guy. So we have a whole conversation about it. And a lot of people are afraid to be called. And again, I'm not, especially when it's attached with respect. And you'd be surprised, most of the time it is, oh, they don't speak to you. So I think we have a job at any time you get to be real intentional about getting our kids back and getting the faith back that they can come to an older person and talk about what's on their mind. And for our young ladies, they need to see what a real man's all about. And I think that men had just as much a responsibility of providing our young ladies with a role model, a model of what a real man's all about. And I didn't think that's very important. That's why we have Simsa, safe in my sister's arms. And we need our boys to understand the strength of a woman and our weaknesses too, and admit to it all the time. And I think a lot of these things that we're doing, it's around negativism, to make it simple. If you think about racism, sexism, adultism, all those words end with ISM on the end of it. And it means that somebody is abusing power. There's nothing wrong with power, but when you abuse it, then it becomes an ism. Now, if you go back to Kukichagalia, then you don't allow nobody to determine what your power is. You determine yourself. So again, each one of those principles will help combat all of those negative isms in our society if we internalize and think about it every day. You know, we just can't all of a sudden now take a whole new fad and say, now let's do this. No, I think it's good to perpetuate what we've been doing for years and do it well. When I was at Ross Prison the other day, 2,000 black men ranged from age 19 to 26 coming out. And I was in a group, I had 50 men in this room. And I just took a chance. I said, I go.
I may.
No, and then one of the guys said, I may. And I walked up to him, I said, how'd you know that? He said, well, back in the day, I remember that, like that. I said, how long ago? He said, about 10 years ago. And he said, I wish I had stayed with it. I said, well, to go to show you that it's still relevant today. And he gave a whole presentation to the rest of the guys about the principle. I was really impressed with him. In fact, I'm making him a leader over there now. So I'm just saying that we didn't need to retrieve and refine and internalize the things that work for us versus switching up to whole new fads.
Well, we are pulling in somewhere. I don't know where.
Man, it looks good.
Yeah, Brother Devin is doing the navigating. I don't know.
Like a white neighborhood to me.
Hey, I mean, it's balling out here.
It sure is.
Look, wrap around driveway and shit. But hey, that's how we do it. We've been nation building.
There goes the deer that run in front of the car.
So, hey, this is Brother High Tim. Remember, like, subscribe, but most importantly, share. Now, this is the type of stuff we're doing on the Yami Journey. Because I got the barber now. I'm trying to bring Elder West. I'm gonna bring Sister Tirahasa. I'm pulling all my people together.
And I know all of them.
Right.
We all come from the same tree.
Exactly.
We're just one of the branches.
Exactly. So, this is Brother High Tim, and I'm saying peace. Remember, join the journey.
Ashe.
Thank you for watching the video. I want you to subscribe. Click the bird right there, the fiery bird. And I also have a special video just for you, right there. And for those that want more information about Jami Journey, go to our site. It should be right about there.